Ultimately, I grew up as a fan of Nintendo. Like, I love
Same.
Nintendo through
Yeah.
and through.
Yeah.
And so that's so to get the opportunity, because so many factors had to like come into play to even make that opportunity a possibility. So it's magic. And the code name for the project was Fate. And because it really did feel like we were destined to do it. Like a dream of mine was to work on Metroid. And then to be able to follow up and tackle Nintendo's first significant character, in Donkey Kong, and to follow up on the work that Rare had done, which again I loved and absolutely adored, both mechanically, graphically, musically. Like, there were so many elements about it. So it was a joy, but it was also a big undertaking.
Hey everyone, welcome to another episode of Convincing Creatives Podcast. Today I'm joined by Kynan Pearson. Thank you for being on the show, Kynan.
Thanks for having me on the show.
Yeah, well, today we're going to talk all about video games and video game development and a little bit about the philosophy behind it and the creativity that goes into it. So, obviously, everyone who is probably anyone has played a video game of some sort, even if they're not the world's biggest gamer. But obviously, like anything, there's a lot of creativity that goes into it. So, before we jump into like specific questions, could you give us just sort of a rough overview of what game design is from your point of view, where you've sat in the past doing projects, and kind of what goes into that to, let's say, the average game that maybe gets shipped out that somebody plays? Obviously, there's many people that work on it, but I'd love to just kind of get that general sense of like what is game design from a creative standpoint?
Yeah, there's multiple facets to game design specifically, but in the greatest sense, game design encompasses everything in a game, from the mechanics that the game utilizes to the structure of the game, how levels progress, how you move through, or if it's a puzzle game, how things are situated that are visualized to the player or that you see and interact with. It can be everything. And so game design is kind of taken for granted, because if it's done really well, it's invisible. But for the most part, if you think about like a movie production, there are a bunch of facets that go into making a movie, and a bunch of different roles and departments and things that contribute to it. But in a game, there are no things that you can take for granted. So gravity doesn't exist in a game unless it is designed to exist. So
Yeah.
you have to account for things that you wouldn't normally account for in other creative fields. So game design, typically, from a creative direction standpoint, I would equate it to almost like the director of a film. They hold the vision for what the game is, and make sure that everything comes together. They rely on the specialties of all of the creative talent on the team to be able to produce everything, and that they can pull it all together, and just make sure that everything does, align, and that you can see how everything fits together so that nothing kind of changes the tone of the game or doesn't fit, or, basically also preventing obstacles. So whenever you get further into production, you'll figure out that this thing is totally not working. What are some creative solutions for how we can solve this? And you can rely on everyone on the team. People aren't necessarily their roles, or limited to their roles. So, engineers on the team could be exceptional designers, or artists. Artists can be, exceptional designers or sound engineers at the same time. So there's a mixture of roles. And then getting a
Absolutely.
little more granular, there's a lot of different types of design, from level design to combat design, mechanics design. You have narrative designers that fit into the design, UI, UX designers for basically the experience, the front end, how information is relayed to the player, and all that stuff. So yeah, it's a lot of
Absolutely.
stuff.
Yeah. No, absolutely. And I'm really glad you laid it out because like all these facets add up to the singular product that, someone is going to pop in their PS4, PS5, GameCube, whatever they're playing, and it'll load up and that's what's going to create the world. And like you said, I love that you said the process is seamless when it's working well, because then you won't notice any of it. Like you said, the gravity, that's something someone worked on. That's an intentional thing. It's and it's interesting too that you mentioned film, because that's my medium. I'm a filmmaker, so like I very much understand what you mean by like the sum of many parts. And that's kind of another question I'm curious about. So when you're in kind of the trenches working on something, you know, you've got a bunch of different teams, a bunch of different people, like how do you make sure communication is happening? How do you make sure ideas are happening while still keeping things on track? Because I do feel like, you know, as someone who's creative, I obviously want to be creative, but also there are deadlines and there are things that need to happen before a certain date. You know, things need to come out, you know, so how do you kind of balance that perfect storm of creativity and also logistics?
It depends. This is going to sound kind of a little different, but historically, when you're doing something like filmmaking, there's clarity in a process that typically works. You're filming scenes. You basically have actors who understand their lines. You find your locations, you film your scenes, you edit it. A lot of it comes together in the editing, and you can fundamentally change a film through editing. With a game, it's different. There is no formalized process that works for all games. Every game is different, and you change a team member on a team, and that game is going to turn out differently. So that's one thing where it's like there's a lot more freedom in game development because of the breadth of content that can go into a game. Like I like to say it this way, that a game can contain all other forms of entertainment. So a game can contain an entire album, a game can contain an entire film, a game can contain volumes of books. Games can contain all other forms of entertainment, but not all other forms of entertainment can contain games. Yeah. And so you have, like, there is the potential that you have to execute at the highest level in every form of entertainment art form put into the game. So from, you know, story mechanics to all of the included content, all of the art, how that's perceived, where you can look, what you do. And it changes based on the scale. So if it's like a small one person team, you have full creative control over everything and it's just limited by your abilities, but you can also learn new things that you apply to the game that you're making. It's really easy for people to overscope when they're a single person working on a singular experience. So it's really important to kind of find out the things that you do well and build your game around those components so that you can kind of cut anything that is unnecessary that might scale the scope. As you get larger in scope, where your projects become really big, it's about teamwork, coordination, and production. So it's about having having the right structure on the team to allow people to creatively make decisions and technically make decisions while working with the other departments to make sure that there's nothing that you're trying to achieve that you couldn't do. And also taking advantage of the team's superpowers. You're going to have some people that do things incredibly well. And if it doesn't matter what your vision for a game is, if you don't have the right people to execute on that vision, then you're not going to end up with the best result. So it's really about production at a higher scale can help organize who's doing what, when they're doing it, when it's necessary to make sure that you can hit your deadlines and your budget. But then also really your leadership, as well as, just your team structure. It may be fairly flat and a bunch of people can contribute to things regardless of whether or not they have roles that say that they are, that they own these particular, areas, of the game. So it's coordination, really. It's getting into a room, having people that have a shared vision, or at least have a shared understanding of vision. Like you might have one person that's incredibly creative that came up with the general idea beforehand and that everyone starts working on it, but it's going to transform radically based on, you know, everyone involved.
Yeah. And I like what you said earlier too, about how if you pull out one or two people and swap someone else in, that entire things can start to change. And, you know, it is the sum of so many parts. And I think that's what's interesting about collaborative art forms, you know, video game design, filmmaking, animation, even like things like that. There's so many people working on so many things that you really don't have room for like a lot of egos and people who just like want to bulldoze something through, because like you said, there's so many different people working together to make a vision happen.
Yeah. And when people are making something from a place of joy, like when you enjoy working with your team, the results are going to be better than when you're working in misery, where somebody's like, I don't really like this, but I guess I'll do it. You know, they're not going to put their all into it. They're not going to want to make that the best thing that they possibly could. So whether or not that's a communication issue, whether or not it's just a bad alignment, or whether or not there are things that could be done to make sure that people are working on the stuff that they enjoy and that they feel like they can bring something to the table, that really makes a difference during game development.
1,000%. And I mean, joy is palpable in any part of life. I mean, people can feel when someone's having a good time. You know, I can obviously especially feel that in someone's art, whether it's games or anything. You know, you can kind of just tell there's a feeling you get. And speaking of feelings, when you're playing something or experience something, that's kind of another question I was curious to ask you about. In terms of just design, how do you make the player feel a certain maybe feeling or emotion through a level design? Because, you know, let's just quickly tee up a few of the projects you've worked on in the past. You know, the Metroid Prime series with Retro Studios, Metroid Prime 2 specifically comes to mind. I played that when it came out, and I just remember the kind of dark and isolating feel of that game. And there was such an interesting way the levels were designed. And actually, I also think about the multiplayer a lot in that game, because I actually had a lot of friends that would come over to my house and play that growing up, because I didn't have the Xbox, so I didn't have like Halo 2 or anything like that. So we would play those multiplayer levels, and it would be interesting because you'd get little glimpses from the single player, and these levels would just be slightly different, and there would just be different mechanics at play in multiplayer mode. So like, could you talk about that, how you're able to also maybe reinterpret levels for different usages?
Yeah, this kind of boils down to emotional expression. And a lot of times people try to reduce a game to one expression. Is it fun? And games don't have to be fun to elicit an emotional response or to have a significant impact. And so like, there is a feeling of, there's an oppressive quality to the feeling of being in the dark world in Metroid Prime 2. That comes from a combination of visuals and mechanics and layouts. And the key thing is that the atmosphere of Dark World damages you, which automatically creates a sensation of anxiety in the players. Just existing is going to force you to take damage. You don't have full visibility and clarity of things like you would in the conditions of the world in its light form. But when you're in darkness, things are darker. It's more, it requires a lot of planning from a design perspective and an art perspective, an audio perspective, to make sure that there's still enough information that creates clarity in players so that they understand what they're doing and what they can see, and try to work out, you know, how they want to tackle difficulties, but also still being able to convey that idea of just a sense of overwhelming threat and a sense of fear and panic as you're kind of moving from light spot to light spot where you're safe. It really does require a combination of different departments and roles to coordinate to make sure that those things come together. But everything in a game matters and was created with intention. So every location that you put an object that has a mechanic that you interact with was crafted to be in that location based on where players can see from where they're standing and what they're able to see from each point in the level. So it's kind of like building a set and making sure that you understand exactly where your camera's at, what your camera can see, to make sure that you've got the proper shot.
Absolutely. And also something that comes to mind with Prime 2 specifically was the difficulty. And I find that really interesting as well. And, you know, I think, so I played them growing up, and I do remember after playing the first one, I played the second one, and I was like, something's different here. And as the player, I felt that. And there was a part of me that got frustrated, but then there was a part of me, and I don't know if this is just me kind of having a competitive nature, I wanted to figure it out. And it was a lot of the trial and error. And, you know, this was in a time prior to YouTube, so I couldn't just go on YouTube and watch, a video game walkthrough and like get the instant cheat code for the level, essentially. Like, I really had to try try different puzzles. And so there is a sense of reward. And I'm just curious, like now in 2022, how do you feel about difficulty in games? Just because, you know, in this day and age, we do have things like Elden Ring and games that really do push difficulty to a degree. But it never felt unfair to me in the way some games today might. I'm not picking on Elden Ring. I love Elden Ring, but just, you know, like some people may not be able to figure things out. And I think there's just maybe a lost art of difficulty, if that makes sense. Because I do feel like a lot of games today either completely hold your hand or are just so intense and difficult that it almost feels unfair. And I guess, like, where did you find some balance in that as a designer?
That is kind of an eternal question. Part of it boils down to player expectations. Like right now there is a sensation, like not a sensation, but there's a perspective coming from players that a game should be a specific way. But the first part of it is that as creatives, it is up to the creatives, whatever they want to do with an experience. So if they want to make something incredibly difficult and they feel like that is where their project has value, then it's their right to do.
Yeah.
But it's also the consumer's right to go, like, or the player's right to go, I don't like it. You didn't do it well. You know, and so you can see kind of things succeed in different ways based on whether or not the players find it engaging and find that the reasons for it validate the difficulty that's there at hand. Over time, that has changed. Like, my philosophies on that have changed. Like, when we were working on Donkey Kong Country Returns, we incorporated Super Guide well, basically, if you died a certain number of times in a level, the tutorial pig would come up and give you the option to basically have the game play through the level for you, but that you could take control of it. So you could, you know, watch Super Kong play through the level to the point past where the most difficult part is, and then you could regain control and then beat the level. So that was, you know, that was to compensate for the fact that the game was far more interesting with difficulty spikes than it was when we were making it a lot more accessible and kind of casual.
Right.
So the game actually was a better game by being more difficult, just based on everything that we had. And the Metroid games, they're not for everybody. Like, it is a genre that requires something of you. So for the players that really dig it, that there is something that's there for them. And the players that don't, you know, they didn't resonate with it, they didn't play it, or they played it and they didn't like it and they can move on to something else. So realistically, there's no one proper way to kind of gauge it. My philosophy now, though, is that even the most difficult games, I would love to see an autoplay feature for every game where you can literally, like, if you're feeling lazy, you don't want to play it, instead of having to go on Twitch or YouTube and watch a playthrough, that you could just do it from the game. You could go, like, play this game. And you just sit there and watch a playthrough happen on the game that you own, that is crafted by the developers to give the experience that they think most represents the game and to basically show it off. So I know it's a long-winded answer, but I think that really it's up to the developers, and, you know, players vote with their money and their attention.
That absolutely makes sense to me. And coming from the filmmaking side of things, I relate to that a lot because my last movie I made in 2020, it was a heavy drama. It was dealing with mental health. It was very, like, you know, not something you're probably going to put on after a long day of work, to be completely honest. And that's okay. And, you know, there's an audience for, and there's a time when people may want to watch that movie. And, you know, if you're looking for a movie to watch after you've had a hard day at work, I totally wouldn't begrudge anyone for watching a comedy or, like, a, I don't know, a Fast and Furious movie. I'm not picking on those movies. I love those movies. Like, you know, there's just different times and places for different experiences, like you were saying. And I like the fact that you are not relegating gameplay to being one way, because there is not really one type of gamer, because, you know, there could be that gamer who's really got the time to sit there and, you know, hash things out and try out different routes in the level, etc. And then you may have another gamer who's like, hey, I got 30 minutes between a break and I got to jump on another meeting or go to a call or go pick up my kids, and they've got 30 minutes and that's what's for them. And so, you know, I love the idea of options, because I think it doesn't have to be an either or. So I think that's really cool that you said that. Something else, too, I wanted to ask about, coming from, like, the cinematic side, story is always such a big part of any experience for me, whether it's art, games, movies, books, whatever. You know, I think some people think story in games has to only be something that's, you know, maybe a super serious game or like a really hefty RPG, but I think like story fits into so many different things because it can unfold in the way a level is designed. It can unfold in the way you're interacting with characters a few different times. Even in platformers, a lot of people say, oh, there's no story in a platformer game, or it's just kind of there to pad things out. What do you feel on that? Like, how does story, maybe narrative design, kind of all fit in?
I also put that in the hands of the creatives that crafted the experience. Yeah. The big thing is that you're having an experience. So right. All games, you know, like there's a range of there's a range of ways that story can be delivered. Just like I can watch a silent film and there's no dialogue, yeah, but it's still an incredible film. And I love the journey that it took me on. So a lot of storytelling can be passive. A lot of storytelling can be environmental. It could be premise. It doesn't have to necessarily be in cinematics and character dialogue or in text or in characters talking. But I think that there's a place for all ranges of storytelling in games. And it really depends on, again, what the creator wants. There's this aspect of sometimes games are created not from a place, I don't want to say a place of integrity, but the developers are trying to provide an experience they think people want. So maybe it might not be something that was their intention. Like they weren't super passionate about doing this thing because they felt it absolutely had to happen in this experience. And so they're just providing it because they feel that it needs to have that in order to be accessible or to reach a broad audience or whatever. So there's kind of, you know, there's different elements that go into play with that as a part of development that are more factors now that we've got data and all of that, that some people are concerned about, and that there's a lot of, you know, a publisher leadership may want something that the development team isn't passionate about. So there's aspects there where, like, taking that out of the equation and just looking at it from the creative intent perspective, I think that anything that can do multiple things exceptionally well runs a chance of creating and crafting a potentially superior experience. So if you took a game that just had an incredible mechanic, but it had no story, and it was like, oh, it's really fun to do this thing, but it's completely, you know, minimalist design, there's no characters, it's just, you know, graphical representations of stuff, that might not be as compelling as if you had something that had an incredible story in addition to that incredible mechanic. And so it's all execution. Like, sometimes it's better to have a game with no story than it is to have a game with a terrible story or a half-hearted attempt at putting a story in just because maybe they felt they needed to, but it wasn't the driving force for making the game. So it's kind of like fine art as well. Like, great artists are able to perceive more things than than artists that they're competing against. And so if you can comprehend color and composition and subject matter and just an attention to detail of how things interact with each other, you can craft something that is greater than the sum of its parts, because everything that is accounted for is done really well.
Yeah.
Game development is the same way. So if you had something that has an incredible story, incredible mechanics, incredible progression, incredible lighting, incredible cinematography or camera work, and all of those things come together and work in a way that feels like it is a cohesive whole and has a crafted intent, then that can oftentimes be better than something that only represents one of those traits well. So
yeah,
Hopefully absolutely. That answers the question.
No, absolutely. I like that because I connected a lot to what you said about sort of just letting the audience use their imagination, trusting them to say, okay, we may not need to hold your hand through a story that wouldn't serve something that we're just trying to do very simply, which is really good gameplay. I also think back to a lot of horror movies that maybe don't have the budget to make a big CGI monster or whatever. So they're really using the narrative to not show you anything because there is really no monster on the other side of the camera, but you feel as if maybe there's a monster on the other side of the camera that you never actually see. And so I think it's like that anticipation that can maybe work in the same way. So that kind of reminded me of that. Shifting gears a little bit, you did mention Donkey Kong, and I want to dive into that because Donkey Kong is one of my favorite games. I absolutely love the work y'all did on it. And just the Donkey Kong Country games as well. I grew up on those. To me, when Returns came out, it was such an exciting moment because it was just cool to see the Donkey Kong Country label return, like, you know, pun intended. And so, like, how did that feel for you to work on something that is just kind of one of these iconic franchises, and especially with that Donkey Kong Country label, obviously the original games that Rare made back in the day being kind of iconic in their own degree. But like, how did you make something that obviously got with the time it was in? Because, you know, you were in a much different generation of games and also just was able to stand out on completely different hardware. You know, I think back to the Wii using the motion controls, like kind of what was that experience like for you?
Yeah, I mean, ultimately, I grew up as a fan of Nintendo. Like, I love Nintendo through and through. Yeah. And so that's so to get the opportunity, because so many factors had to like come into play to even make that opportunity a possibility. So it's magic. And the code name for the project was Fate. And because it really did feel like we were destined to do it, like a dream of mine was to work on Metroid and then to be able to follow up and tackle Nintendo's first significant character, you know, in Donkey Kong, and to follow up on the work that Rare had done, which again, I loved and absolutely adored, both mechanically, graphically, musically. Like, there were so many elements about it. So it was a joy, but it was also a big undertaking because it had been a long time since, you know, Donkey Kong Country had been kind of a presence whenever we were recreating it now for a new generation of hardware and with our own studio's kind of fingerprint in it. And that afforded a lot of interesting things because the game could have gone a number of routes. Like, we could have had, you know, a spline-based camera where instead of the game progressing like a side scroller built in 3D, you could have been winding through paths and, you know, or even a full 3D representation. Like, those could have been options, but because of the limitations that we imposed on making sure that it was traditional 2D side scrolling and then taking advantage of all of the opportunities to amplify the experience based on those limitations where we had absolute control over the perspective of the camera. So we could do things with like parallax aligning in the background or elements coming from the background into the foreground or you firing into the background. Those were new things that we were able to do that couldn't be done on the previous hardware as easily because it wasn't fully 3D in terms of the representation. So that was an opportunity to kind of just creatively escalate from where they had kind of laid a foundation prior to us, taking that and then running with it and seeing all the interesting mechanics that we could incorporate and scenarios. And basically, we had this friendly competition amongst, you know, designers, artists within the company of basically one-upping each other. And it was like,
nice.
It was really rewarding because we would do these things where we would have Monday morning meetings and anybody that had something cool, we're like, hey, show it at the Monday morning meeting. And so we'd get full playthroughs of a level that's in blockout form, but you could see the foundation of all the cool stuff that interplays and happens from the background to the foreground, so that then the next time that we would see it after it had a fully arted pass would be this beautiful, like, and team rallying experience of like somebody seeing something, they're like, oh man, that's so cool. Yeah. I can't wait to show off what I'm working on. And that really Because that was a short turnaround on the game. We had 2 years, and we were going from a team that had previously worked on first person to working on a fundamentally different genre with completely different rules applied to how that comes together in a quality way. And a lot of the foundations and philosophies that, you know, would work for something like the Metroid Prime games wouldn't apply to Donkey Kong Country Returns. So it was both a learning experience as well as just this creative opportunity to shine and let people express themselves in ways that, you know, you couldn't do with something that's a little more serious in tone.
Right. And I think back to just, again, what you can do in a platformer. Obviously, like you mentioned, very different type of game. It functions differently. The audience might be slightly different, majorly different, you could argue. I mean, you know, there's a lot of different things at play. But for me, I do love that y'all were able to take some interesting creative and aesthetic jumps from the original Donkey Kong Country games that just made this one stand out. You know, I think very specifically to the first time the sunset silhouette level happened. Like, that moment I will never forget. I remember that very distinctly. I was playing the game and then that moment happened. And I almost like got chills just because it was just so cinematic and it was so fun. And like, I remember just walking around the level for at least 2 or 3 minutes, not even playing, just looking at it, almost like it was a painting. And it was really just a cool experience to sort of just, it stopped the way I was playing the game for a few moments, which was actually really fun because it was surprising. So I don't know if that's a question or just a compliment, but I really appreciated that. That was fun. Yeah.
We knew we had something special even at the time working on the game when seeing Matt Manchester was the artist that did the original version of the silhouette and kind of pushed for that when we had some experimental time in early production to figure out different art styles and stuff. And that came up and it was really special. And we knew that we wanted to take advantage of it. And you see it's a foundation moving forward even into Tropical Freeze.
Yes, yes. And it carries over in there as well, beautifully. Well, that's, again, just something cool. And I'm also curious, too, as a creative, this is slightly different, but like, how do limitations inform your creativity? I know you mentioned this Donkey Kong game, it was a 2D side scroller with 3D elements. You said, you know, there's maybe an alternate universe. It could have been a 3D Donkey Kong game. You know, I know those, you don't see fully 3D platformers quite as often. I mean, they exist, but like, what is it maybe about the 2D space in addition to maybe nostalgia? I think there's something else there. I think there is a very different way those games play than the fully 3D platformers. And like, could you maybe talk about what some people might say is a limitation actually is just a completely different genre of gaming? Like,
yeah, I mean, limitations aren't limitations in the same way that, you know, like saying it sounds like, oh, you're limiting what you're doing, but it's kind of like crafting something around an understanding of as far as you're going to push it. So for instance, you know, plays, you understand that when you're making a, let's say, Broadway play, that you have seats in the audience and everyone's going to be viewing the play from a certain direction. And so you can craft your lighting and your scene composition to the real estate of that, the set or the stage. And then it affords you the opportunity to, because that's a limitation, now express things that are unexpected within the constraints that you have. And so when you do things that like surprise or shock somebody, because it's like, I can't believe I'm watching this. Like, how did they transform the set while people were on it? Like the logistics that had to go into it, the craft and the passion and the planning to pull that off. And it was only afforded because they knew what their limitations of the venue and the technology that they could use to pull it off. So, a 2D side-scrolling camera, for instance, in Donkey Kong, gives you the ability to, like, you're actually taking a bunch of other stuff out of the equation that you no longer have to worry about. It's like, I don't need to worry that somebody like in a first person game, can run up to a wall and put the camera as close into the surface as they can and see it. And still I have to worry about, does the gun clip into the wall? Do we render the gun after that to make sure? What happens to the shadows? Is that going to create some bugginess there? Do we have the gun prop up? Whatever. There's all these things that you have to solve when you have limitless potential of doing everything. And right. So applying a limitation actually, you know, can open up the ability to say all of our attention now is going into this one component instead of having to worry about all of these other things that snowball that we would have to take care of. And so that can be, you know, like you could have single screen games where let's say you're playing on your phone and you literally see the entire background on the phone at one time. That means that image could look like any still from any movie you've ever seen. It's not a limitation in that, like, oh man, the camera doesn't even move in this. It's literally, you have the option to make it look like any image that you have ever seen. It can be crafted around what you're seeing. And so I don't know if that is
absolutely
dancing around or if that's actually expressing what.
No, I think that's very well put. Cause I think, you know, I don't remember what it was, but I think there's always like a group of gamers that like think that something being fully 3D, fully, you know, pushed on the highest graphical capability, that's always going to make the best game. And I mean, obviously we know that's not true. The best game, A, is subjective, and B, is really going to acclimate to the taste of the player and the taste of the designer. And like you said, every game is not going to be for every person. And I think, you know, that's kind of where I think about limitations, whether it's this, I mean, a film, you could say, okay, you have a $5,000 budget for one film and a $5 million budget for another. You could still make two very good films, but you're going to make two very different films. And a $5,000 film is not going to have, you know, as many actors, as many locations, any CGI probably, you know, so like many different things can come into play. So I always think that like limitations, like you said, give you a very good railroad track for the train that is your creativity. And you kind of just know what you're dealing with. You know, you may know what you're not doing, but sometimes that informs what you can do. And and I find that really helpful as an artist a lot of times. Something else too with platformers while we're on them, this is just me nerding out because again, I'm a big gamer. I love platformers. That's one of my favorite genres. Like, what is it to you that informs a fun platformer, both as a designer, but also someone who just enjoys playing games? Like, for me, I think there's two things that click really well. It's like certain levels have to challenge. It's kind of like I was saying earlier about Metroid 2 or Prime 2, like, the challenge has to be there where I get a little frustrated, but I'm able to solve something. It's like solving a puzzle, and I'm able to do through trial and error something that makes me feel like, oh, I accomplished something, you know? And then the other thing for me just has to be the controls. Like the character has to control well. I think about jump, like one of my favorite jumps is Crash Bandicoot, the way he jumped. Like that's a game that always works well, very fluidly in my brain as platformers. So like, is there anything to you that would stand out on like a list like that?
Yeah. I mean, this really digs deep into design philosophy in a number of ways. So for instance, with Crash Bandicoot's jump is slightly floaty, but their levels and the level progression and jump distances are forgiving as well. So there's a little bit of like a sloppiness that they can get away with in the planning of their levels because of the way that their mechanics work, the way their camera works. And that actually is a preference. It's a feeling that you get. So the mechanics play into the structure of level and the progression, and everything matters. So for instance, like in just using Donkey Kong Country Returns as an example, the spike, the hardest difficulty point in any level, typically in Donkey Kong, comes after a checkpoint. So the first half of the level, let's say, is used to give you safe scenarios to have an understanding of how the mechanics and the gimmicks or interactive components of the level work. So for instance, if there's platforms that go up and down, then you're jumping across those in a relatively safe scenario. And then we start intermixing those with some other elements or changing the timing up, so you actually have to think. But a lot of times, messing up won't cause death immediately. or it's easy enough to kind of compensate based on the mechanics that you'd used in previous levels, so that the player already is coming into a level with a little bit of dexterity and understanding.
Yeah.
Then after you pass a checkpoint, then that is your opportunity to just do something a little jarring and surprising, where it's like, okay, you're gonna come upon this thing, you're gonna see it, and you're gonna do it, but it's like, oh, it's like the craziest timed version of the moving platform, where the platforms come together and crush you. So that when you respawn, you don't have to run through the entirety of the level to get back to that frustration point. And then you can actually try multiple times to compensate and learn in rapid succession to get past it. And then the difficulty ramps back down to more medium difficulty rather than ramping back up to the highest difficulty right before you reach the end of the level. So it's part intention and craft to make sure that the level's fun when it gets hard, but that you're not frustrated that the level didn't account for when that was going to happen, and make sure that, you know, you didn't have to do a difficult ramp over and over and over until you get to the end, you die, then you have to do that again, and then you die. That's frustrating because it doesn't even give you a chance to, like, potentially learn and respond, because it's so far away that you might have forgotten what you need to compensate with before you get there.
Right.
And then mechanics tie into that, so it's everything. It's from camera. What does the camera show you? So a lot of games, sometimes they'll have a camera rigidly attached to the character so that as you're jumping, your character is pretty much always in the center of the screen. And that means it's really hard for you to gauge if pits are below you, and if you fall into a pit and you're going to die, or if there's land below, because the camera's following you up. So you can no longer see what was down at the bottom of the screen. And so all those things play into each other, and they create basically a snowball effect of a combination of mechanics and details that need to be accounted for to craft the experience the way that you want it to be. And developers of differing levels of experience may not know all of them. They may not account for them, or they may not even be valid for whatever the experience they're trying to create. So it's a combination of what you recognize, what you polish around, what you craft with intentionality, how you craft it and progress, and then how it looks, because that can also change your perception of the experience that you're going through.
Yes, absolutely. And what I love about all this is these are a multitude of different decisions and conversations that have happened over time with the development team, with developers. And like you said, all these things might seem like they're just happening through osmosis, but you know, again, like you said, someone designed that checkpoint to appear at that particular part of the level, and also, like you said, to give you sort of an on-ramp through the first half to allow you to get to there and understand like the mechanics at play. So then it's like, okay, you understand what to do. Now you're really going to be tested on the knowledge. So, and I think that's where the reward comes in as the player. So that's a very, I love that you laid it out that way, because now that I'm thinking back to a lot of different games, I'm starting to see some of that roadmap, you know? So I think that's very cool. Yes. In terms of, you know, just working through philosophy, how do you challenge yourself years into your craft? You know, I bump against this a lot creatively. You know, the whole point of this show is to talk to all kinds of creative people and just get a sense of what it is they do, why they love doing it, but also how they keep going. Because, you know, sometimes you hit bumps where you say, oh, I've done this type of thing before, or, you know, I could almost do something in my sleep. And I think that's where it's important to challenge yourself and try something new. And I love your earlier point about coming from, you know, the Metroid games, which are very different than the Donkey Kong Country Returns game. And, you know, going into other projects you've done too. I know you spent time on Halo, multiplayer. You know, how do you kind of see all these different points as kind of all different, let's say, checkpoints in the journey, you know? And then when you're going to the next thing, like, how do you keep yourself sharp, creative, but also just like not overthink this process? Because I think this is just something a lot of us creative people get into as we're 5-10 years into something plus. Like, how do you keep that spark?
everyone is different. So the things that apply to me don't necessarily apply to others because there's, you know, my brain functions in a certain way and I'm drawn to certain things and I've had different experiences. So that's the part of everyone is different. So everyone will bring something different to the table. But I honestly do think that you're never not a student. You're constantly learning.
Yes.
And the only way to learn is to attempt something that you haven't done or to push yourself into areas or to even restart something. And the great thing about games is that lessons you learned that worked for a prior game do not translate to the next game to guarantee success. So just because you did it that way does not mean that there isn't a better way to do it or a different way to do it that can give more impact than the way that you've done it before. The other thing is basically learning from all disciplines. Like if, you know, you're stretching yourself thin and you think that, I mean, anyone who thinks that they're the top tier best in their industry is, you know, fooling themselves. They may have prior experiences, but you can even see like, you know, movie directors that have made fantastic films for so long, all of a sudden start making stuff that doesn't resonate with people in the same way. So you can never rest on your laurels and just be like, you know what, I'm the best. But doing cross-departmental where, you know, you start branching into, like if you're a designer, then learning more as much as you can about art or audio or engineering or animation will enhance the perspective that you have on even the things that you design and change the way that you look at things. The other real part of it is that, again, there's no rules, but if you're not, if you're not collaborating, if you're not learning, if you're not constantly trying to better yourself or tackle things that are interesting, then you'll eventually be left behind because the results of your works previously are there for anyone else to see and understand. And if they take that and then use it as a springboard to do even bigger, better, greater things or different things or shocking things, or they're doing stuff that that just amplifies the work that you had done previously and you're still doing the same thing, then it's not going to have the same impact anymore. Because, you know, there's part of the attention span and the joy of shock and surprise and unexpectedness that imprints on players. And you can never have a first experience again, repeating the same thing. So it's kind of like, it's almost like there. I've heard the thing, you know, where people talk about bad ideas, and realistically, if you took an incredible idea and gave it to a mediocre team, and they executed it where they were just kind of happy with the first results of everything, they could still end up with a really bad game. But you could take an incredible team and give them the worst idea in the world and be like, you know what, do a game about elephants juggling. And through their execution and through what that team does with each other, they could turn an elephant juggling game that started as a terrible idea into an incredible idea just through the execution and through the evolution of the process to get there. So I think that, there's just attention to detail in your craft, constantly learning, constantly pushing yourself, and absorbing as much as you can from the talent that you surround yourself with. And so if there are people that are doing things that you think are exceptional, then either find a way to talk to them or try. Because, you know, just like playing an instrument, the first time you pick it up, you're going to sound terrible. And then as you progress, you're going to get better and better. And you may find that you have a talent there that, you know, requires the work to get there though.
Yes. And I love what you said too about the example of someone just, you know, feeling like, okay, I've made it. I've done what I needed to do really well on this one project. Now I'm just going to repeat the formula time and time again. And I think that's where you get people who get stifled because they think, okay, this was successful 10 years ago, 30 years ago, whatever, just going to keep doing it, rinse and repeat, and they're not challenging themselves. And I think they do that out of a place of, oh, I don't want to fail, so I want to do something that was successful and safe. However, by doing that, they're actually arguably maybe coming closer to failing by just kind of going through it. And I know it's all subjective, but like, I do like what you said about taking a risk and doing something different, because that's how you grow. And like, that's the eternal student mindset. If you just do the same thing every single time, I think your audience is going to trail off and find other people who are trying to innovate, you know? And I think that's where innovation is really important. In terms of creativity, is there something you wish you knew, let's say, like when you first started out that you know now? I'm sure there's, you know, all of us could say many things, but like, if you could kind of like give yourself a piece of advice or just something to not worry about, is there anything you would like stand out that you would say?
Yeah. When I first started out, my taste was way ahead of my skill set. And I would always try to push things further in ways where it was like, I'm trying to differentiate. I'm trying to make something new and different from what anybody had ever experienced. So I was constantly like breaking the rules before I actually learned the rules and kind of how they applied. And so the way that I describe this is like the, you know, like if you're going to make a landmark, the Eiffel Tower is striking in its form. It's elegant. You know, it is recognizable to anyone. You can put it on a sticker and it's all good. But I'd be like, oh, I want to do a tower, but I want to have a bridge and I want to have some giant thing rotating in there and a giant, and you know, whatever, this balloon on the side. And so I'd end up with these medleys of a bunch of different elements that were all competing rather than trying to find some simplistic, subtractive, minimalist, elegant way of just representing the idea at its highest level. And so a lot of people in their early phases will be like, I want to break the rules. I'm gonna put this enemy here and this other enemy here and this gimmick over here and this thing. And their level won't have an identity, or their game won't have an identity, because it's trying to do everything and it's not succeeding at doing any one thing in the most, you know, definitive manner. So I think that the thing that if I could go back in time and basically rewire my brain or tell myself something that would save a lot, it's that it's the impact versus effort thing. What is the least amount of effort you need to spend to get the most amount of impact on something? And a lot of times it's distilling it down to a much more meaningful, iconic idea than it is trying to throw the kitchen sink at it.
Yeah. What, are there any moments and levels of games that you've just played, you know, recently or otherwise, could be games that are ages old, that maybe kind of force you to stand still? Like, I know it's probably the same for you. Like, I can't watch many movies without critiquing cinematography. I'm looking at editing. I'm saying, why did they frame and light the way they did? I'm sure when you're playing a game, it's the same thing for design. Like, are there certain ones that still to this day can kind of get you to turn your brain off if it's just that good and seamless? Like, is there anything that like stood out to you?
This is going to be backwards and probably not resonate with anybody. But I love fighting games. Fighting games is, yeah, my favorite genre. I think that they provide something that other games don't. When I started playing Street Fighter III Third Strike, or actually even just the Street Fighter III series, regardless, the parry mechanic was something that, like, it's so simple. You just push forward into an attack, and you know, you'll end up in a situation that is more advantageous to you if you do so. But you're pushing forward into an attack, so you know, it's the opposite of what you've been trained to do, blocking by pressing back away from an attack. That mechanic is so simple and so elegant that it both makes and destroys that game for anyone. If you do not use the parry, then you can't play that game at any remote high level of play. Like, you have to understand the parry to be able to fully enjoy the game. But it's a complicated mechanic that requires custom timing for everything, but it's super simple and elegant to do. And it ruins the game for anybody that just wants a more, you know, that wants to play something like Street Fighter 2 or even Street Fighter 3 or, sorry, Street Fighter 4. But it's genius. Now I feel like it is the best fighting game that has ever existed, and no one will ever be able to do it again because it broke the game, and no one would make that decision again. They're like, it's too that mechanic is too tied into the entirety of that experience. But when you're playing as a player who understands it and loves it and uses it, being able to just completely parry anything that somebody does and retaliate provides something that no other game can offer. I know it sounds silly, but now they do mechanics where it's like, let's just take Street Fighter 4, focus attack, where you press two buttons to like eat an attack, and then you have to double tap forward to like cancel out of it to be able to retaliate if under certain circumstances. It sounds like it's easier, and some people think it's more accessible, but it's way more complicated and arbitrary. And it's not an elegant solution. It's actually a really arbitrary solution. Nobody would ever attempt to do that of their own accord without, going through menus and looking at button options and watching videos to break down this mechanic. It doesn't feel intuitive to just try. So, anyways, I know long story
No, I
there.
love it. Yeah, no, I think that's great. Something else I'm kind of curious about, just to get your take on, and I don't want to say what I think because I don't want to influence anything, but some folks say, video games, it's all about multiplayer these days. Single player is taking a back seat. What are your thoughts on that as a level designer? Because I know you've done multiplayer stuff and single player stuff. Is there a difference? Does that even matter?
Here, the way the industry kind of works, and this all is, well, it's really easy to say that multiplayer is kind of where things are going, but realistically, it's not. Like, you still have a ton of single player experiences. And looking at, let's just say, God of War Ragnarok, which is coming up, it's going to be a pinnacle single player experience and journey. One of the things that single player games can do that multiplayer games don't have to like don't can't do is the control of the pacing of the experience, the control of all of the elements. Other players are going to be random. Like, they're going to make sure that you're going to have a different experience every time, no matter what, varying skill levels. But when you're playing something single player, it's consistent. It's consistent for you, and you can, it's much easier to craft the results. The other thing is that there's still things that can happen in computing in a single player scenario that networking can't handle. Like, you just can't send, so much network data that, you have these full giant massive physics simulations crumbling and dynamic, mechanics that allow you to do all of the stuff that you can only do in a single player situation in a multiplayer situation just because of the ping and data loss. So by focusing on only multiplayer, or that multiplayer becomes the dominant genre, there's all these limitations that still are pretty necessary to account for that prevent you from doing a lot of stuff that you could do with single player. So anything, even a bad experience, is fun socially if you're playing with friends. So you can run around with something with terrible mechanics, and just because you're playing in a group, it's actually kind of fun. So it's almost a cheat to be able to achieve. But as we're seeing, everyone's trying to do multiplayer, not everyone's succeeding, and the games that don't have a large enough player base to even support multiplayer just fizzle out of existence and you never hear from them again. So it's a good thing to run at, and there are benefits of doing, like, it's always fun to play games together with people, but I don't think, like, there's a lot of there's a lot of cloning of other people's experiences to try and achieve the same results. And again, it's kind of like, you either have to take the throne or make your own. Like, if you're not going to be the best game to play in that genre with whatever that game's defining feature is, if you don't outright beat them, then there's no reason for players to move from that experience that they're already enjoying, and they might even start to get bored of, to come to some other multiplayer game that's doing the same thing, just maybe a little worse. So I would love to see more innovation in the space. And multiplayer is a key component of the future. But I do think, like, even if you look at something like Game Pass, Game Pass, just like Netflix, affords you the ability to play a bunch of unexpected things in a single player setting if you wanted, that don't have to be full length. That it's kind of like it's the variety of what you get, rather than the specific intention and craft of one game having to support an entire studio and being the only thing everything or nothing scenario, where it's like, oh, we need to make a, you know, huge scale AAA game that costs so much and it's multiplayer, because then we're going to reach, you know, we'll be able to have cosmetics that you can share with all the other players that are playing. But if it fails, oops, I mean, that's a big loss. So I think that, you know, there are desires and factors that are pushing people towards all multiplayer in the current climate, because everyone wants the same success that they see somebody over there having. They're like, oh man, this game, you know, Fortnite, oh, that's a big deal.
Yeah.
Maybe we could do that just like them. And it doesn't always work out. So really, it's if it's the team's driving desire to do it and they succeed, they need to do it on their own merits. There's nothing they can assume is going to come together exactly as it did for any other game. They have to build everything from scratch. And if they change the experience and make it something that you can't get anywhere else, then in my personal view, that's the thing that I always like to see, when a team really brings something new to the table and creates a space for themselves, rather than just kind of copying another space and hoping to see the same success.
Absolutely. And like we said at the top of the show, I think it's just coming back around to if that team loved it, that love and joy is going to come through on that final product. And if they did it because everyone else is doing it, it's probably not. And you know, I tend to always lean towards a single player experience. That's just my cup of tea. You know, all my favorite games are single player experiences. However, you know, I have fond memories of playing Halo multiplayer with friends. And so like, I totally can see, maybe even for younger gamers, that's a generalization, like multiplayer is more important. And maybe at one point in my life, when I was, high school, college, it was probably more of what I was playing, but then I kind of circled back around to single player. And so, you know, I don't know if that's a generational thing or not, but I do think it's, there's a place for both. And, you know, I like the thought being, if their heart's in it, it doesn't really matter if it's a single or multiplayer experience. It's going to be a good game. It's going to stand out. There's going to be that special sauce. So yeah, I like that.
The thing to throw in there though, is just because you do it doesn't guarantee success.
Yeah.
So you can have the best game in the world
and oh, yeah.
doesn't mean it's going to be successful.
Yeah.
But like in the current climate, you know, there's a lot of people that are, you know, watching movies.
Yeah.
Typically it's older generation, but there's younger people that enjoy movies, but you've seen more and more, you know, moving towards YouTube, where it's like, okay, the algorithm likes 10-minute videos. So more people are doing 10-minute, and then you go to like TikTok and like YouTube shorts and all. And then it's like, now people's attention spans are like a minute to 20 seconds to 10 seconds. And a lot of people like to just be kind of lazy and just let experiences come and go. So
yeah.
Multiplayer games require a certain amount of effort that just by human nature, it requires more of you to engage with a multiplayer thing, because you got to wait for matchmaking. You got to wait for all these things. Your experience is totally dependent on other players. Whereas you may want to play something for 15 seconds, or you may want to play something for 4 minutes, or you may want to just be, you're sick and you're on the couch and you can turn on a show, or you can just kind of play something single player without having to spend that much effort. And more people can relate to that than, you know, the alternative. So it's like, if you want to hit all of humanity, then something that's a little more passive or doesn't require as much just constant awareness and interaction could actually do better if you reach everyone.
And it all comes into like knowing your audience and kind of understanding what do they want out of that experience. Because I'll be honest, I've played more video games on my Nintendo Switch than probably any other console in recent memory, just because it's on my desk or on my nightstand or next to the couch.
Pick it up and play whenever you want.
Yeah, I can knock out 20 minutes of something you know, and I know it sounds weird. It's like, it's not that hard to go sit on the couch and turn on the TV. Like, it's not a hard task, but there is something to be said about the immediacy. It's like your phone. You just pull your phone out of your pocket. It's just one step closer. And so, yeah, I don't know where I'm trying to go with that, but I resonate with what you were saying.
Well, it's almost like any technology removes more and more friction to do the same thing. So like playing a record, you had to pull the record out, put it on, put the needle where you wanted. If you wanted to get to whatever song you wanted, you might, it's like an analog process. And then you had tapes that were a little more portable, but you still have to fast forward. And then you had CDs where you had all tracks available, but then you still had to put it in and the laser. It's like sometimes you'd have to scratch on the disc, and then you have MP3s. Oh, cool. I literally have every song that's ever existed on my phone available right now, this second.
Right.
And so eventually we're probably going to hit the point where you don't even need your device necessarily. You've got your AR goggles on and you can just go like, I want to play, you know, Super Mario Brothers. And you're just playing it right then. You don't have to, like, there's no pulling out your device or anything. It's literally just like, it can happen in the moment. You're already looking. You can create a virtual screen. So the things that make people able to get to things more conveniently with less friction at any point in time will do better than the things that require the friction. And so getting up off of your couch, walking over, pressing the power button on something, like now you can just pick up your controller and press the power button on the controller and it will launch your system. So it's more convenient. So it takes less effort. But those are all advances that have happened naturally just to remove friction points and get people into the experiences faster.
Yes, absolutely. I haven't even thought about the fact that we turn modern consoles on with the power button on the controller. I mean, I know that we do that, but it's like lost to me. But yeah, I mean, my GameCube over here, I love retro gaming. If I turn that on, I have to walk over to it and push the button. And like, you know, that is not the case with the Switch. Even if it's docked, you know, you still have the control. You can turn it on immediately. I love that. And that's, again, we all come back to that's intentional design. That's intentional decisions. That's, you know, conversations that happened. And that's what I want to highlight with this podcast is just all of these little things that we take for granted. They do have to come from somewhere. So.
Yeah, it's done by intention. And again, full circle, if it's done well, it's invisible. It just feels like, yeah, why wouldn't you do that?
Right.
But it had to evolve to the point that that actually became something that people put the attention to detail into crafting to make it happen. And so, but the more of those things that happen invisibly, then the more that players or consumers or viewers, depending on whatever medium, they take for granted. And they just assume that that should be the way the case with everything. And so, but those things still have to be made.
1,000%. I love it. I love it. My last question to land the plane, so to speak, I ask everyone this at the end of every episode. How do you convince yourself to be creative on the hard days, or maybe you don't need the convincing? What is it about creativity that just gets you out of bed in the morning just to go try it again?
It's what I... there is an unyielding motivation. Like even when I'm in my worst state and I'm depressed, there's more joy to come from creating something from nothing than there is to just existing and doing nothing. Like I feel the reward after making something new when it's said and done and I can look back on it and be like, okay, cool. I did this with my time today. And that feels more valuable to me than if I had wasted it. That's part of it. The other, which is that for me, I constantly have hundreds of projects at varying, you know, levels of completion or not even having gotten started. And if I find that I don't have the motivation to do something, that because I've got so many options available, that if I'm just blocked, then I can engage with something else. And my biggest mindset is that I do not look at failure as a failure. I look at it as a step towards success. And so just taking any step, no matter how poor, gives you something that is now malleable that can be, you know, turned into something exceptional. And so, like, if you don't take that first step, you'll make nothing. Like, write a song. If you want to write a song, just start. It could be the worst song in the world, but making that first step to writing it would get you closer to having a great song that you have written than trying to think through all of the things that could go wrong, or like, I don't know how to write a song. And so you just procrastinate and you put it off until you feel like you can do something good, because you're too concerned with failing to even take that first step. And so don't worry about quality. Don't worry about judgment. Don't tell anybody you're doing it. Just get up and do something. And it can be bad, but if it's bad, you at least still have something and you can make it good.
Yeah. I love that. No, that's fantastic advice. I think people forget that not everything has to be put out there. You know, you can just make something experimental because it leads you to your next project. It gets you excited to do something different. You know, maybe because you did an acoustic guitar song, you suddenly get an idea for an album. Or you think about a video game where you are playing the notes on the screen and someone came up with Guitar Hero. Like, you know, I don't know. Like, there could be a million outcomes from these types of things, but I think that's wonderful advice. Kynan, thank you so much again for your time. I really appreciate it. Do you have any departing words, anything you want to plug, talk about before we wrap up?
The only thing that I want to say is try to find smaller scale things to support, because it's really easy to destroy. It's really hard to create, and smaller creators need the attention more than the giant juggernauts and monoliths in the world. And so supporting smaller creators will lead to more people taking those bold steps to making something from start to finish. And the more you can support smaller creators and more unique creations and things that have potential but don't necessarily have the full execution, the more people will be in the pool to being able to make those bigger creative endeavors in the future. And so, yeah, not supporting the small crews and not supporting the small projects is actually strangling them and potentially teaching people to not even try.
I think that's great advice, and really appreciate you saying that. And, you know, a lot of us struggle when we're doing something small scale, because it's like, who's watching? Who cares? But, you know, it is that time it takes. Like, I always tell myself, you know, don't give up 5 years into something because you're just getting started. And some people be like, 5 years is a long time. I'm like, it is and it isn't. Like, it all depends on your outlook, you know?
Yeah. It's over before you know it.
That's what they say. So, yeah. And thank you again. Really appreciate your time. And also thank you for working on the Prime games. I know it's many other people as well, but I really do appreciate those games. So I just wanted to thank you as well for working on them. So.
Yep. Well, I am glad that they were able to bring you joy, and thank you for having me on. And I've really enjoyed talking with you, and let's chat again.
Awesome. Likewise. Y'all take care. Subscribe for future episodes of Convincing Creatives. You can get it on YouTube for video versions and Apple Podcasts, wherever you get your podcasts, online for the audio versions. Thanks for listening, and we'll see y'all in the next episode.